if you're just in a hoping that things are going to get better, I guess that is okay, but that's not the best. The best way is to put your faith in the Lord and trust God that His promises will prevail. Every person that's in this place has to deal. Some people have to deal with it on a daily basis. Some of you live with it, and so you have to deal with it all the time. But God has His grace. Everybody say, God has a grace, and God has a strength that we don't have to handle it like the world does. That we can handle it the way God wants us to handle it. That even though that bitterness is such a hard thing, that God is bigger than bitterness, and God can turn that situation. I tell you, the Lord knows just how to push our buttons. And somebody says, they pushed my button. And you know, that was probably a gift from the Lord, because God wanted to be exposed what was in our heart, because God wanted us to deal with it. God knew that unless we're able to come in past bitterness, we will never be able to fulfill the real purpose that He put us on earth to do. If we allow that to find a root inside of us and build into bitterness, it cuts us off from the powerful blessings that God put us on earth to walk in. And so we've got to find, as a believer, probably as a believer, this is the thing that each one of us need to learn to handle more than anything else. Someone intended to set a trap for you and to cause you to fall. It wasn't human, though, was it? Because we know that by the offenses that we... How many times I've offended people and have no idea that I've offended them. Never intended to set a snare. But there is an entity behind this. There is a conspiracy that's going on against our lives. And his name is Satan. Can you say amen?
Welcome to Victory. I want to thank you for being a part of our Victory family today. Thank you for watching the program. I'm the senior pastor at Victory in Camden and Victory in El Dorado. We have campus pastors at each one of those, and we just want to thank you for being a part of our audience. Thank you for letting Victory be a part of your family and a part of your life. During the service today, there will be a telephone number at the bottom of your screen. If you would, take advantage of it. Let us know what's going on in your life. If God is dealing with your heart, if you're rejoicing in your heart, things that we can stand with you and pray with you about, call that number at the bottom of the screen. Let's go right into that service at Victory now.
A snare has three qualities. The first quality of a snare is seductive. It's going to deal with something you want. It has a seduction dealing in this thing. It's going to deal with something you want. Maybe it's a friendship. Maybe it's to be respected. Maybe, but it deals with something that you want. The second characteristic of it is subtle. That's why the devil is revealed as a snake. He'll ooze into your life undetected, and then he'll ooze out. He'll sliver in. It comes up in places and ways. It always surprises us. It always surprises us. Always the wound always surprises. See, because it always deals with the wound. Unforgiveness always deals with a wound that has been set. But it's usually up out of nowhere. It's by a person we least expected it. But God gives us a way. Everybody to saw the neck or saw the head of that thing off and to do it God's way. Can you say amen? And that's why it says in 2 Corinthians, we were saying, who's behind it? Who's behind setting this snare? If Jesus said they're going to come, but Jesus said there are predictable set snares, that somebody has devised this. They may be using Joe, or they may be using Henry, or they may be using Sally, but no matter who they're using, it's been conspired by somebody that's much more evil than Sally and much more evil than Joe. It's been conspired by hell. And that's what Paul is explaining to us in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9 and 11. He said, I wrote to you as I did to test you and see if you would fully comply with my instructions. You remember what I talked about, God test us? That's what it says. God tests us to see whether we would do it His way or not. God allows battles. They don't come to Him. It's not, He's not the source of it, but He allows us to be tested to see whether we will do it His way or not. Amen? So that's what he says, to comply with my instructions. When you forgive this man, we're talking about forgiveness. When you forgive this man, I forgive him, Paul said. And when I forgive whatever needs to be forgiven, I do so with Christ's authority for your benefit. And then verse 11 says this. It's the secret of who's behind the snare. Verse 11 says, so that Satan will not outsmart us. That's what he says. Who's behind that snare? Oh, I know he used Sally. I know he used Joe. I know he used somebody. But who was behind it? And God all the time is there watching me to see if I will blame Sally, if I'll blame Joe, or if I'll blame the real rascal that slithered into our life and deal with it like God told us to. Amen. So notice what it says. It says, and Satan, so that Satan will not outsmart us, Paul said, for we are not ignorant. Everybody say, we're not ignorant. You know why we're not ignorant? Because the Bible tells us that there's a snare, but we also have that conscious voice. Now you got that other voice that said you can't trust them, you never can trust them, they won't listen to you, no need of saying anything. But there's another voice, and what we've got to do is allow God's voice to become the predominant voice in our life. We've got to allow God and trust him. Everybody say and trust him. Remember where Saul fell? Because he didn't trust God. He didn't trust God's timing. He said, I can't wait on to do it the way God said do it. I can't wait on God. Saul said in 1 Samuel, he said, I feared. And I want to tell you, that's what emotions will do to you. When a wound has been laid against you, if you allow that wound to be dealt with by your emotions, it's going to set you up to fail God every time. But if you will deal with that according to what the Word says, the Bible says we're not evil, we're not ignorant of his evil schemes. Amen. Hebrews chapter 12, 15 says this. See to it that no one fails to obtain the grace of God. God gives us the strength to deal with bitterness. You know what that strength is? Somebody say the grace of God. In fact, what the grace of God does, it stands in complete opposition to bitterness. On one side, you got bitterness. On the other side, you got the grace of God. It's not because you're just good enough to forgive. It's not because you can just look over it. If you're looking over it, you're taking a wound that's got infection in it, and you're putting a Band-Aid on it. And you're going to get sick from it. You're not going to be able to deal with it. And so what the Lord is telling us here then, evidently, is the grace of God. Notice what it says. That no one fails to obtain the grace of God. That no root of bitterness, he just speaks, that no root of bitterness springs up. And notice the two things that it does. The two things that bitterness does is going to cause you trouble. And that's what it did for Saul. It caused him great trouble. In fact, it caused him to lose the purpose of God that he was on earth to fulfill. It caused him to lose everything that God had put him here to be able to accomplish. And that's what bitterness does. Bitterness causes trouble, and notice what else it does. What else does it do? And it defiles many, or the Bible says there, and many become defiled. So that bitterness, if it's there, is going to trouble you. It's going to torment you. And then it's going to set you up to torment and hurt others. Offenses will come. Now, wounds are offenses. When we say offenses, what we're talking about is wound. It's immediate to understand that. The first thing I want to say to you about them, that they are unavoidable. Everybody say they're unavoidable. It's unavoidable. There's going to be wounds that's going to happen. In fact, the word bitter, you know what the word bitter means? The word bitter in the Greek is the word pikros, which means pierce or cut. It's a wound. When we talk about the word bitterness, what God's saying is a cut or a wound. Someone's hurt you. Someone's stabbed you. Someone's cut you. Either intentionally or unintentionally, somebody has been hurt. Amen? And all bumps and bruises are usually not intentional. Now, I've got older. How many found yourself doing that same thing? Or you dead one? That's the only two choices. You find yourself getting older or dead. But I found out that as I got older, my skin has gotten thinner. You find that, especially if you're old. And it just, never intentionally, I don't care what I do, I mean, I can be doing any little insignificant job. When I bump myself, it builds a mess. Lane's always coming and saying, "Wow, what happened to your arm?" Or, "Wow, what happened to your leg?" Nothing. Never noticed it. Because, see, what happens is, as you get older, your skin gets thinner. As your skin gets thinner, then it becomes more perceptible than to being bruised. The slightest little thing, then, can just bruise it. I want you to know that's what happens in our life. It becomes a wound. It's usually never intentional. The enemy says they intended it. Well, I've got to put a silence to the voice of the devil, and I've got to let the devil know I don't believe it was intentional. You know, that's the way Jesus kept from being bitter. When he was on the cross and they crucified him, he prayed this prayer. He said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." You know, if I would have been there, I'd say, "Jesus, burn those rascals. They knew exactly what they were doing." Because it looked like to me they did. I mean, Jesus was always loving them, caring about them, healing them, helping them. But they crucified him. But Jesus was determined, "I'm going to do it God's way. I'm not going to let bitterness get into my heart." See, love says, believes the best of every person. It said every person. I wish that would have said, believe the best of the good people. It'd be much easier for me to deal with. But it doesn't say, believe the best of the good people. It said, believe the best of even the bad people. Believe the best of every person. That means I got to give them an excuse. And I'm not giving the excuse for them. Because God is a God of justice, and God will judge them. If I'll trust him, anyone that does me wrong, there will be a penalty, but I will not be the judge of it. God in heaven will be the judge of it. I'm going to be honest with you. About the worst thing I could do is snub them. But it's not with God. When God wants to show somebody's wrong, he knows how to show them that they're wrong. Can you say amen? So God expects me. So that's the way Jesus taught me to do it. Jesus said, give them an excuse. And so every person that did Jesus wrong, every person that drove that nail into his palm of his hand, and those that drove it in, and those that placed that crown of thorns and pushed it into his brow and he bled, he gave them an excuse. And he said, "God, they didn't know what they were doing. They didn't know it because Jesus knew there was a snare that was set against him. And Jesus knew there was somebody behind Joe. So there was somebody behind Alice. It was somebody behind Sam. And it wasn't Sam and it wasn't Alice. There was conspiracy that was going on behind the scenes. And it was Satan himself that was coming against the Son of God." He knew that. See? Amen. All right, number one, fences are unavoidable. The second thing about a wound, they're memorable. You're going to remember them. Because you know what? The word bitter comes from that word pikros, which comes from the word pneuma, which means that second stage of bitterness. And that second stage says to drive a stick or to set a peg. Anytime that you allow whatever's happened to you to be dealt with in your emotions, it's a hammer on that stake. It's no longer just a cut, but now it has become something that's been driven into your heart. And it's formed a horrible scar in the midst of your heart. And so the Lord says we have to deal with it. Amen. Then there's a third stage to it. Wounds also are vulnerable. They're vulnerable. They're dangerous. They're prone to infection. In fact, where we get our word, one of our words for medicine comes out of this very thing, the result of bitterness. Because another word for that deals with this bitterness, it's, not only does it mean a stab, but it means a poisonous stab. That means there has been something that has been launched against you that has a poison that's inside of you. Scott was a single pastor here for a number of years. And Scott was such a precious friend, man. And he's with the Lord now. But something had happened in Scott. He went away on one of our single trips. And Scott was always that daredevil. He should have been a dare angel. He had been taken care of, but he was a daredevil. And so he launched off of a high cliff. He went up North Arkansas. They launched off a high cliff. And when he came down, he went so hard into the water, went down and cut his leg. Well, they rushed him to the hospital, and everything seemed like it was okay. But then all of a sudden, I got a call that now Scott has been rushed from somewhere, I think Russellville or somewhere in a hospital, has been rushed to Little Rock Hospital. And so when I went to Little Rock, I found Scott in one of the worst situations. What had happened is they had closed the wound with the infection still there. Let me say this, we're a master at doing that over our wounds. We're a master at closing our wounds and never allowing the blood of Jesus to cleanse those wounds. When I got there to that hospital at night, it was a horrible story with Scott. I went in there. I thought they just did this on television. They said, Scott, we've got to open that wound up again, and we can't give you any medication for it. And they had one of those. I thought that was just cowboy stuff. They literally took a square stick and they said, Scott, your pastor's here. He's going to be praying on one side of you. And you're going to take that stick and put it in your mouth. And we've got to lance it, son. We've got to get it open. Got to cut that whole leg. Got to get that thing opened up. Because if that infection stays in there, you will die. I tell you what, I cried. I prayed. I did everything I could through that surgery. I'd never been waked through a surgery like that, you know. And I stood there holding his hand as he would scream and bite that stick. But that's where some of us are. Exactly. Face sake, we've tried to hold it just right, keep our smile. We didn't want to appear to anybody else that we were hurting. And so what we've done, we closed that wound up. And now there's a terrible infection inside of us. That's where 1 Thessalonians is so good. When it talks about the area of coming through bitterness, it literally says this. It may take many tears. One version, I love the way it says it. Well, that Scott that night, I saw tears. I saw a strong man cry like a baby. I saw him scream till he almost and probably did pass out there, trying to get that out of him. But you know, he did it. And we lived past that, and his leg was healed. You'll live past this. But that bitterness has got to be dealt with. If you let it stay there. Because see, it's opposition. Remember I told you bitterness is opposition to grace? Grace is the way God's kingdom. Grace is God's influence on us inwardly that changes the way that we respond outwardly. You understand? Grace is God's dealing with us. It's his strength in us inwardly. It's God's affecting us inwardly that changes the way we can deal with things outwardly. God's grace in your life to overcome hurt and to truly forgive. Somebody say, well, I forgive. I'll never forget it. Honey, you really haven't forgiven. Because the Bible says you can't just forgive from your head. You got to forgive from your heart. It's got to be a heart, man. And it's heart-wrenching. And sometimes it may take days to forgive from your heart. Sometimes it may take weeks. And for me to finally come to a place to forgive my daddy, it took years. And it may take years with you to come. But if you won't give up the fight, Jesus will never give up the fight for you either. If you keep fighting through it to get rid of that bitterness, Jesus will keep fighting for you to come over it for the glory.
I started drinking when I was 20 years old because I couldn't deal with a lot. When I got that first buzz, it just felt good. I mean, no worries, no nothing. So it led to one thing to another, and I just kept drinking. I mean, it's bad. I drank so bad till when I was 26 years old, I totaled out 2 vehicles in less than a month. I was on my way to work. I was late. They called me, woke me up. I'd been drinking that night, and I was on my way to work, and I hydroplaned. So here I am. I'm finna go to jail. I'm facing DWI 3, leaving the scene of accident. I'm facing 4 charges. I sit in the jailhouse for 2 days. I didn't eat. I couldn't sleep in jail. I could think about what was I gonna do. I see those people in jail. I was like, I don't like this right here. You know, I was at rock bottom, bro. I was facing DWI 3, could have used jail time. I was finna lose a lot. On Monday morning, I got out. I went back to my room that night. We didn't have no TV, so I couldn't do nothing but think. I just got down on both my knees. I did. I cried out to God. I said, I'm done. What is it you want me to do? I give up, you know. I'm just here. Just work in me. Tell me what it is you want me to do. I cried like a little baby. I got up, started reading the Bible. I started at the first beginning of the Bible. That next day when I got up, it was just something different. It was different, dude. It's like somebody shined a light on you, ain't gonna lie. And I was still facing 4 charges. I still had to go to court. Well, I was worried about it for a little bit, but then I kept reading my one a day. I'd read them, and they said you can't worry and pray. If you pray, why worry? You know, so here I gave it up. I told God, I'm going to have acceptance. I'm going to accept whatever you give me. I've done this. I got to be a man about it, you know. Well, that night, I was reading that and thinking about it. I was watching Joel Osteen, and he was talking about obedience brings blessings. And I was just thinking, yes, I'm here. I got down and went to praying. I just told God again, just whatever happens, just let me be strong and learn from it. I mean, got up that next day, went to work, and I left work, went to court. And before I can even sit down, the police officer wrote me the tickets, come to me, and pulled me to the side and said, we're going to drop this charge, we're dropping this charge, we're dropping this charge. I'm telling you, it was crazy. I went from running from the Bible when people was talking about God to when I heard a conversation about God, I had to get in there. You know, I had to get my 2 cents. And they're like, you know, everybody's wrong with him. He's totally different, you know. And then life has just changed, no doubt. I can't even see a piece of paper on the floor and not pick it up now. I got a conscience telling me, pick that up. I'm telling you, somebody saying, pick that up, pick that up. Or you don't supposed to do that. It's wild since I've got saved. Sometimes I feel crazy. I tell my wife, am I crazy for thinking like this? July the 10th this year, I'd be 3 years sober. Hadn't had a drop. Not a drop. I not even wanted one. I mean, and I've got more people see me how I used to be and how I am now. It's like, I mean, I got to get this. Brother Jerry's talking about this year is going to be the year you put your family in church, you know. And I've been praying about that. Now I got my sister coming to church. She's bringing her boys where I used to bring them every day. And I turned around last Sunday and I got my half brother that I had to look twice. He comes to the house after the Super Bowl and we talk, and he just told me, he said, man, I seen you and I'm proud of you. And if you can do it, I can do it. That's exactly what he told me. And every night I pray that God uses me to influence somebody else's life, to see what I used to be and where I am now. That way, to let them know it can be done.
To hear more victory testimonies of lives changed, healed, and restored, log on to www.thevictorychurch.com/mystory.
I believe the Holy Spirit has touched our life today. I believe that the words that were spoken, I believe God is dealing with us. And for many of us, maybe we need to make some things right with God. Maybe there's some areas of our life that we need to surrender to Him. Maybe there's some things that the Holy Spirit is asking us to come over or come out of. Can I pray with you? Can I pray with you and ask God to forgive us? Can I pray with you and ask God to help us to surrender those areas of our life? Can I pray with you and ask God to help us to be able to change things through His power, to be able to live differently, talk differently, think differently, and be different? God can help us do that. That's all in the areas of God's strength and His power, is to help us live a victorious life. Let's pray. Would you pray and say, Father, forgive me for my sin. Forgive me for my failure, And Lord, I ask you to come in my life. And Lord, right here today, I ask you, God, that you would be Lord of my life. And Lord, in the issues of my life that I need to surrender to you, the areas of fear and discouragement, the things that's caused me to be depressed and those things that's hit hard on me, or those things that's tried to come into my life and overcome my life, Lord, I come today to surrender them to you. I know that you're able, God, to free me, to help me. And Lord, I surrender them in Jesus' name to you. And now, Lord, I ask you for your grace and for your strength to overcome. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Call that number on the bottom of the screen. Will you call us and let us hear from you? Will you let us be a part of your support team? Let us be a part of that team that's going to be praying with you and standing with you and believing God with you. And also on the website, let us hear of your prayer request. God bless you. And I pray that this week will be the strongest week in the Lord you've ever had. Look forward to it next week. God bless you. Hi, I'm Pastor Jerry Abrams. Thanks for watching Victory Today. Victory is a church that's all about people, all about excitement, and all about what God's doing in your life. We want to invite you back to watch each week for another exciting time together. To find out more about Victory, give us a call and let us know how we can be a part of your family. God bless you, and thank you for watching the program today.
We're excited to introduce the all-new Victory Church app, now available on the Apple App Store and the Android Market for your smartphone and tablet. Get church information and download free content from Victory. Don't miss a service. Listen to past week's messages on the go, new after each service in the Camden and El Dorado campuses. Access Victory TV on demand and watch all the exciting video series taught by Pastor Jerry and the Victory Pastoral Team. Send a confidential prayer request and let the Victory prayer ministers believe God with you for your miracle, and take advantage of our most convenient way to give with a secure Victory Giving section, where you can choose from many easy ways to give your tithes or sow into specific ministries of the church at your convenience, right from the palm of your hand. It's all at your fingertips on the new Victory Church app. Download for free today. Simply go to the Apple App Store or the Android Marketplace right on your smartphone or tablet and search for the Victory Church Arkansas and click on the Victory logo.